Ja, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, liebe Gäste, lieber Sadiq al-Asim, lieber Navid Kermani, ich freue mich sehr, sehr, dass Sie heute so zahlreich zu uns in die Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung gekommen sind, zu diesem ganz besonderen Abend. Seien Sie herzlich willkommen und ganz, ganz herzlichen Dank für Ihr großes Interesse an dem geschundenen Syrien. Hier in der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung diskutieren wir zu diesem Land nicht das erste Mal, aber ich denke, mit Navid Kermani und Sadiq al-Asim ist es ein besonderes Ereignis hier in der Stiftung und ich freue mich, dass Sie so zahlreich hier gekommen sind. Ich möchte mich natürlich ganz herzlich bei beiden Gästen des Abends bedanken dafür, dass wir Einblick bekommen in ihre Sichtweisen, in ihre Perspektiven, wie sie die Lage in Syrien, aber auch wie wir mit Syrien umgehen, einschätzen. Ich möchte mich hier schon an dieser Stelle ganz, ganz besonders beim Centre Marc Bloch bedanken für die sehr gute Kooperation. Schön, dass dieses Zusammenarbeiten geklappt hat. Die Anfrage an uns kam sehr kurzfristig und ich glaube, es ist gelungen, dass wir hier gedeihlich kooperieren. Die Resonanz zeigt es uns. Wer aus Syrien zu uns kommt, hat meist Schlimmes gesehen und erlebt. Innerhalb Syriens die Schrecken des Krieges und auf der Flucht die unmenschliche Arroganz, mit der Europa seine Außengrenzen verteidigt. Wer aus Syrien flieht, flieht vor Gewalt, die sich in vielen Formen ausdrückt. Dazu gehören die vielen Luftbombardements. Auch wenn sie zu Beginn der Waffenruhe weniger geworden sind, für viele Menschen in Syrien sind sie rasch wieder zum Alltag geworden und gerade die letzten Tage erleben wir, wie mehr als 30.000 Menschen vor den Bomben auf der Flucht sind in und um Aleppo. Die kriegerischen Auseinandersetzungen zwischen Rebellen der ISIS und dem Rest der Welt gehören sowieso, weil sie immer ausgeschlossen waren von der Waffenruhe, zum Alltag der syrischen Bevölkerung, die noch vor Ort auszuharren versucht. Und die Menschen in Syrien erleben vor allem die Gewalt eines Regimes, das der eigenen Bevölkerung vor mehr als 5 Jahren den Krieg erklärt hat. Menschen und Kulturgüter werden Geisel eines Tyrannen, der um keinen Preis von der Macht lassen will und der nur, um selbst besser dazustehen, zugelassen hat, dass sich der sogenannte Islamische Staat mit genau der gleichen Brutalität wie er selbst an den Menschen auf seinem Territorium vergeht. Vor mehr als 5 Jahren begann in Syrien der Aufstand gegen das Regime von Bashar al-Assad. Das Leid der Zivilbevölkerung, die Repression, die blutige Gewalt, die dem ursprünglich demokratischen Aufstand folgte, sind unfassbar. Der brutale Krieg hat über die Hälfte der syrischen Bevölkerung zu Vertriebenen gemacht. Hunderttausende sind tot, weitere Hunderttausende verschwunden. 1,5 Millionen Kinder, Frauen und Männer darben in Gebieten, die Assad unter dem Vorwand der Terrorismusbekämpfung kollektiv bestraft. Nie wurden die Grauen eines Krieges, noch während er stattfindet, eindrücklicher dokumentiert und veröffentlicht. Und trotzdem ringt sich die internationale Gemeinschaft nur zu halbherzigen Versuchen auf, den Konflikt zu beenden und lässt die Region mit den Konsequenzen weitgehend alleine. Umso wichtiger ist es, unverbrüchlich daran festzuhalten, dass es eine Lösung, so schwierig sie auch sein mag, möglich ist. Die Widerstandskraft und Tapferkeit der syrischen Bevölkerung ist zutiefst beeindruckend. Gerade vor einer Woche fand an vielen Orten der Welt das syrische Handyfilmfestival statt, das Syriens Bürgerjournalistinnen und Journalisten würdigt. Das ist konkrete Solidarität. Das macht den Medienaktivisten und Aktivistinnen und Journalistinnen Mut, die zu den Gefährdetsten in Syrien zählen. Ihre Waffe sind die Filme, gedreht unter dem Radar der Autoritäten und dennoch zutiefst riskant. Selbst im antiken römischen Theater von Bosra spannten Aktivistinnen am 8. und 9. April eine Leinwand auf, um ihre Filme dort zu zeigen, auch auf die Gefahr hin, dass das eine deutlich erkennbare Zielscheibe aus der Luft sein kann. Und dieses Beispiel ist nur eines von vielen, wie die gesamte Brutalität dieses Krieges es nicht vermocht hat, den kreativen Geist der syrischen Revolution zu vernichten. Navid Kermani und Sadiq al-Assem, zwei der intellektuellen Größen unserer Zeit, haben sich nie gescheut, die Auseinandersetzung mit unbequemen Fragen zu suchen, oft gegen erhebliche Widersprüche. Jahrzehntelang hat Sadiq sowohl in Syrien als auch außerhalb eindeutig für die Menschlichkeit und für wechselseitigen Respekt Stellung bezogen. Politische Gegner schüchtern Sadiq al-Assem nicht ein. Er begreift den politischen Diskurs, den Dialog als Essenz des Miteinanders. Navid Kermani und Sadiq al-Assem mögen kulturhistorische Differenzen haben, und ich bin gespannt, ob heute einige dieser Differenzen zum Tragen kommen. Der Philosoph Sadiq al-Assem hält es als für notwendig an, dass der Islam eine Aufklärung durchlaufen möge. Navid Kermani wiederum vertritt den Standpunkt, der Bruch mit der Tradition, eine, wie er sagt, zivilisatorische Amnesie einer Kultur sei dringlich, einer Kultur, die vor Jahrhunderten weitaus aufklärerischer als die westliche Kultur gewesen sei. In einem sind sich jedoch beide einig, dass es wichtig ist, zwischen Glauben und Wissen zu unterscheiden und dass politische Macht sich nicht über konfessionelle Orientierung definieren sollte. Und sie teilen die Vision von Gesellschaften, die die Vielfalt als unschätzbaren Vorteil und nicht als Problem begreift. Bunt, nicht schwarz-weiß, so stellen wir auch uns als Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung die Zukunft Syriens vor, in der alle gesellschaftlichen Kräfte zu ihrem Recht kommen und sich beteiligen können. Die Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung hat eine Reihe kürzerer und längerer Dokumentarfilme unterstützt, die die Situation in Syrien und die Lage von Flüchtlingen thematisieren. Ob Fachgespräche, Konferenzen oder Podien, in den letzten Jahren hat die Stiftung mit einer ganzen Bandbreite von Veranstaltungen über ziviles Engagement für eine bessere Zukunft in Syrien gesprochen. Und dabei ist es uns, und wir haben Partnerinnen in Syrien, ein wichtiges Anliegen, dass nicht über die Köpfe der Syrerinnen und Syrer hinweg gesprochen wird, sondern dass wir mit ihnen und durch sie sprechen. Wir stärken denjenigen Kräften den Rücken, die in Zeiten der Flucht, der Furcht vor Extremismus und Terrorismus oft übersehen, ignoriert oder nicht ernst genommen werden, obwohl sie gerade diejenigen sind, deren Gestaltungskraft für ein besseres Syrien essentiell sein wird. Ob Bauern und Aktivistinnen des Kollektivs der 15. Garten oder das von der 2013 entführten syrischen Anwältin Rassan Zaytuneh mitgegründete Women Center oder an politischer Bildung arbeitende Organisationen wie Daulati, wir unterstützen Sie und hoffen, dass wir Ihnen Mut geben mit unseren Initiativen, die alles sind, als allenfalls ein bescheidener Beitrag zu dem, was die Syrerinnen und Syrer selber auf die Beine stellen wollen, immer noch auch aus dem Land heraus. Es ist schade, dass Dr. Basma Kodmani, Mitglied der Nationalen Koalition Syriens und die Expertin der Arab Reform Initiative, heute leider krankheitsbedingt nicht bei uns sein kann. Ich finde, wir sollten ihr von hier, vielleicht hört sie auch über Livestream zu, von ganzem Herzen Genesung wünschen. Ich möchte mich jetzt noch einmal ganz herzlich für die Kooperation mit Marc Bloch, mit dem Centre Marc Bloch bedanken. bei Ihnen, bei unseren Gästen. Und ich möchte auch die Gelegenheit nutzen, weil ich weiß, dass sie zuhört, vor allem auch Bente Scheller, unserer Büroleiterin im Libanon, danken, unserem Team hier, Antonie und unseren Nahostleuten, die immer wieder, ich sagte es schon, genau das versuchen, was wir versuchen als Stiftung, Mut geben, Beiträge leisten, auch wenn insgesamt wir sagen müssen, dass wir uns mehr wünschten, nämlich Frieden und eine Zukunft für die Syrerinnen und Syrer. Danke dafür, dass Sie hier sind. Ich gebe nun weiter an Katrin Gousseff, der Direktorin des Centre Marc Bloch, die Sie ebenfalls mit ein paar Worten hier begrüßen wird. Herzlichen Dank.
Meine Damen und Herren, guten Abend, Herr Kermani, guten Abend, Herr Hallhasen. Als Direktorin des Centre Marc Bloch ist es mir eine große Freude, Sie heute Abend begrüßen zu dürfen. Die heutige Veranstaltung Syria from Within ist ein Ereignis. Wir dürfen zwei Persönlichkeiten von großer Autorität hinsichtlich der Diskussion über die Syrien-Krise begrüßen. Den Orientalisten Navid Kermani, Träger des Friedenspreises des deutschen Buchhandels, dem ich sehr dafür danke, dass er mit großer Begeisterung unsere Einladung zu dieser Debatte akzeptiert hat. Und Sadiq Alhazen, dessen Präsenz am Centre Marc Bloch schon sehr vertraut ist. Seit letztem Herbst ist er Fellow an unserem Institut. Die Unterstützung, die wir diesem herausragenden Intellektuellen zukommen lassen, reiht sich rein in eine Bewegung der Mobilisierung und Solidarität mit den Flüchtlingen, die in Berlin sehr stark ist. Das Centre Marc Bloch, ein deutsch-französisches Institut für Geistes- und Sozialwissenschaften, orientiert seine Forschung auf Europa und darüber hinaus. Aktuell engagiert sich das Centre Marc Bloch im Rahmen neuer Forschungen zur Neuanordnung des Mittelmeerraums. Die Anwesenheit des heutigen Abend, die Anwesenheit Sadiq Alhazen als angegliederter Forscher des Centre Marc Bloch sowie die Organisation des heutigen Abends sind vor dem Hintergrund dieser anstehenden neuen Forschungsachse zu betrachten. Was könnte spannender sein, als zwei große Intellektuelle heute hier zusammenzubringen, aus zwei verschiedenen Generationen, die sich mit Geist und politischem Engagement in die großen Debatten der Begegnung zwischen Europa und dem Nahen Osten, in die Diskussionen um den Ort der Religion und in der Gesellschaft und die Freiheit von Kunst und Meinung angebracht haben und einbringen. Ich danke der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung, von allem Ihnen, liebe Frau Unmüßig und liebe Frau Nord, für die Mitorganisation dieser Veranstaltung und den Empfang in Ihren Räumlichkeiten heute Abend. Wir freuen uns sehr über diese erste Kooperation mit der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung und würden uns sehr freuen, wenn diese ein Ausgangspunkt für weitere gemeinsame Aktivitäten sein könnte. Herr Baumann und Frau Arnold von der Böll-Stiftung sowie Luzi Kühl und Julian Hübner aus unserem Haus danke ich sehr herzlich für die Mithilfe bei der Vorbereitung und Organisationen dieses Abends. Auch möchte ich mich sehr nachdrücklich bei Markus Messling, stellvertretender Direktor des Centre Marc Bloch, bedanken, der die Idee für diese Begegnung hatte und verantwortlich für deren Umsetzung war. Ich bin mir sicher, dass die Debatte dicht und lehrreich sein wird für uns alle, die versuchen, die großen Umwälzungen im Nahen Osten umfassend zu verstehen. Vielen Dank.
Guten Abend auch von hier. Wir wechseln jetzt ins Englische, damit wir alle miteinander diskutieren können. Welcome. Now we switch to English, so if you need headphones, please put them on. Thank you very much for coming, everyone. It's a very special occasion and it's a very special lecture, not only because we have, as we heard, two very special guests, Sadiq Al-Azm and Navid Kermani, but also because it is a special occasion to bring those two people together. It has a history. From what I heard, they started a discussion in autumn when Navid got his book prize at the Frankfurt Book Fair, and they wanted to continue this discussion. So my role is very minor. It's very easy. They have a discussion and they want to continue, and we have the honor to listen and to hear the different points of view. The only problem was to find out what was the discussion about. So I asked Sadiq Al-Azm, what was it about? What do you want to discuss with Navid Kermani? And he said, yeah, I would like to discuss the role of religion in the conflict in Syria and in the process of solving this conflict. And then I asked Navid, and he said, no, it was about how the texture of the societies, the old traditional texture of the societies in the Middle East is falling apart, and that we should discuss about that. So I think there are two subjects, they are linked, and they are both very interesting, and I think we will be able to touch both of them. But first of all, I would like to introduce my dear panelist here. I will start with Sadiq Al-Azm. It's a very great pleasure to have you here, and it's extremely difficult to describe you. He is a philosopher, a former professor of philosophy, and he is certainly one of the most critical and most controversial and most influential voices and thinkers in the modern Arab world. And he didn't leave out many hot topics in the last 50 years. So he started in 68 with a book on how the Arab intellectuals handled the defeat against Israel. He continued with Nakd al-Fikr al-Dini, which is, I think, until now his most important and mostly read book. It's the criticism of the religious thought. And he started to talk about political and the rise of political Islam. Then he moved on to Occidentalism and criticized Edward Said with his thesis on Orientalism. And he touched on conspiracy theories later on. So I think it's a very big range of hot topics to talk about. But he's not only a philosopher and thinker, he's also a political activist. So right from the beginning, when the young Bashar al-Assad came to power and there were hopes for a Damascus Spring, he was one of the very brave people from the opposition to raise his voice, and he is also one of the people who brought up the Charter of the 99. So he started the revolution, he's one of the persons who started the revolution long time before the revolution started in 2011, and certainly when the revolution then started in 2011, he still supported it, and he is still in like one of the people spearheading this movement and still raising his his voice to defend it and to bring it to success. And there's something else, and that's quite new for since a little more than a year. He's also a Berliner. So we are very honored to have a new Berliner amongst us. And it's at least that's something good about the crisis in Syria, that we have you here now. And we have the chance to hear a lot from you at different occasions. And for tonight, we will have the chance to listen to, he will start with a small speech about Syria from within, how he sees the conflict, and perhaps if we are lucky, we will also hear how it will be possible to solve it. Before, I would like to introduce Navid Kamani as well. He will later on react to the speech, and I think most people of you will know him. He is one of the best known and most influential German writers. When he was awarded this Friedenspreis des Deutschen Buchhandels at the Frankfurt Book Fair last autumn, he was honored as one of our society's most important voices. Like Sadiq Azem, it's not so easy to describe Navid Kamani because he as well has many disciplines. He is an Islamic scientist. His Habilitationsschrift, the book he brought up as out as a postdoc degree, God is Schön, God is Beautiful, was very widely read and translated into couple of languages, and it's a quite influential book in the field of Islamic science. He is also, or he used to work as a dramaturg in theaters, and he is also a novelist, just to name two of the very well-known books, Die von Neil Young getöteten, the ones who got killed by Neil Young, or Dein Name, Your Name. I think they, yeah, they are two of the books that were widely read in the last years as well. Navid Kamani is also a journalist, so he has traveled the region, and he has traveled to Syria a couple of times also in the last years. And he has just published his latest book, Einbruch der Wirklichkeit, which is on the long track of refugees coming to Europe. And Navid Kamani is also an activist. He was a member of the German Islam Conference. He delivered a very well-known speech for the 65th anniversary of the German Constitution, the Grundgesetz, which was very widely discussed. And I think he is the best example that it's extremely normal to be Muslim and German at the same time. And not only that, you can be many other things at the same time. So there are many identities to be held at the same time without big conflict and a big problem. Thank you very much for coming. It's nice to sit next to you. Thank you. But before we hear more from Navid Kamani, I would like to ask Sadiq Azem to give us his insights on the situation in Syria.
Thank you very much, Julia. Is the voice coming well? Okay, good. And of course, much gratitude to Heinrich Böll and to Centre Marc Bloch for hosting this event in favor of Syria. And I am, of course, very much indebted to Navid for making the trip and the effort to be here. And it is my honor to share the rostrum and the forum with him. The title is Syria from Within, but I will start, first of all, to say something about Syria from without. At the present time, Syria from the outside looks like a mere passive object of history and politics, manipulated by the rules of the great game of nations, decided by higher geopolitical strategic calculations, directed solely according to great power plays, rivalries, and ambitions, used and abused by the clashing interests of a defensive Saudi Arabia, an aggressive Iran, a defiant Turkey, and a resurgent Russia. Syria from within is a subject of history, an active agent of politics, a people that patiently endures, reacts, acts, explodes, and goes into a massive intifada against long-abiding oppression, literally shaking the world and preventing it from going to sleep. Syria from within is the Damascus Spring, the dress rehearsal for the Great Arab Spring, and the last flicker of hope for Syria before the worst case scenario went into effect. Syria from within is the famous Charter 99. Remember Charter 77 of Czechoslovakia. Charter 99 sparked Syria's short-lived civil society movement that gave birth to the decisive civil society documents and declarations of the time. Among them, the famous Declaration of the 1000, documents and declarations that first formulated and clearly anticipated all the slogans, demands, shouts, cries, symbols, and aspirations of the Arab Spring, reverberating throughout the Arab world, Tahrir Squares. Syria from within is a fearless revolt against the tyranny and arbitrary rule of the merchant military security complex, arrogantly and insolently dominating state, society, economy, and law to the detriment of everyone else and to the detriment of everything else. Following is the story of present-day Syria from within. After the violent 2001-2002 suppression of the Damascus Spring with a civil society movement and the burial of its famous Charter 99, and after the assassination of Rafiq Hariri in Beirut in 2005, and the consequent humiliating withdrawal of Assad's troops from Lebanon, an infection of existential angst and an anguish of the mind spread throughout Syria out of concern for and fear of what the immediate future had in store for the country. Attendant on this affliction were nervous feelings, contradictory thoughts, conflicting emotions, and nagging premonitions that Syria was tottering on the edge of an abyss. During this troubled and uneasy period, life seemed to flow routinely and peacefully on the surface throughout Syria. Intuitively, we all seemed to sense that underneath this calm, something else was happening. We tried as much as we could to turn a blind eye to this disquieting reality, hoping it will stay below the surface for a long, long time. I remember having to work in Damascus and live with this contradiction between the false calm of the surface and the deeper sense of the volcanic lava underneath, making itself increasingly felt by the day. All this took its toll on me, like a lot of others, mentally, psychologically, and politically, in the form of chaotic condition of stress, deception, avoidance, pretense, recognition, suspense, dissimulation, fear, hope and anticipation. I and many like myself in Damascus found ourselves driven almost imperceptibly to weigh very carefully every word, phrase, metaphor, and joke to be uttered, depending on what we know about the affiliations, not only of our passing interlocutors, but also of our best friends, colleagues, and associates. Broad socializing and visiting lost almost all spontaneity. Confidence and trust evaporated, while offense was quickly taken as never before. The traditional solidarity of much of the Syrian intelligentsia against abiding oppression became racked by an unusual dose of doubt, suspicion, and mistrust. It quickly became evident to me that the Sunni-Alawi divide and antagonism brewing under the surface caught up with la crème de la crème of Damascus society. By 2009 to 2010, it was impossible to go about the chores of daily life in Damascus without repeatedly hearing from the simplest people in the street expressions like, all it needs is a match to ignite. It needs a spark to flare up. All it needs is a firecracker to explode. And it took a non-entity like Bouazizi in Tunisia setting himself on fire for it all to explode. He was the match, the spark, and the firecracker that all those simple people expected, feared, and talked about. The more educated and cultured, particularly the members of the intelligentsia in Damascus, had their own favorite metaphors for saying the same thing. The internationally recognized Syrian cartoonist Ali Firzat, left for dead on the roadside by the thugs of the regime after a famous cartoon, put the matter this way in an interview with Newsweek in 2007. Either reform or le deluge. The deluge expectation was very much in the Damascus air. The late Omar Amiralay, one of Syria's most prominent film auteurs, had released his movie of 2003 with the title Le Deluge du Ba'ath and suffered for it later on. A prominent colleague and friend in the philosophy department went about emphasizing that the worst has already happened, that is, the big antagonistic divide in Syrian society is already a fait accompli. My favorite metaphor was to say that Syria is now a pressure cooker where the heat and the pressure are mounting by the hour and where all the safety valves have been destroyed. Interestingly enough, a band of young musicians in Damascus had announced themselves under the name the Pressure Cooker. Now they are active in Beirut, Lebanon. The visible but unseen official policy of willful blindness vis-a-vis the gathering storm on the part of the power structure was the talk of the town. This raised in all kinds of minds, of disbelieving minds, the question whether it is credible at all to assume that this literally incendiary situation really escapes the attention of the establishment and its inner circle. This in spite of all the operating spies, the CTI system, the available instruments of surveillance and manufacture of consent, the multiplying intelligence services, and the ubiquitous mukhabarat with their innumerable branches and extensions. The answer to this question that one would hear at street level is Allah ami albun. That is, God blinded their heart as to what was really boiling under the surface. But we realize that this willful blindness resulted from a deeper subliminal perception on the part of the inner circle and its accomplices, that the system has become so brittle that tampering with any of its parts in the name of reform would lead to the quick collapse of the whole edifice. Add to that the regime's self-serving delusion that it had instilled enough of the culture of fear in the Syrian hearts and minds that any gathering of a few persons that can be instantly dispersed by firing 3 or 4 bullets at most. A blinkered policy of security solutions for the mildest objection, expression of concern, or alarm. After the American occupation of Iraq in 2003 and the regime change that occurred there in favor of the Shia Arab majority, it did not take long before for Syria to want the same for itself. Damascus murmured with wonder at the time, if the Arab Shi'i majority can have Iraq, why can't the Arab Sunni majority have Syria? Actually, with the regime change in Iraq, Syria had reached a crossroad and refused to cross. Or more accurately, the Assad regime did not let it cross. So the explosion finally occurred. All in all, Syria by then had become a divided, dangerous place with intimations of anarchic violence. Beneath Damascus's shiny surface, a malignancy of hatred and oppression was growing and mutating into a winding mass of violent energies ready to spring, and spring they did. Practically every Damascene at that time had one prayer on the tip of his tongue. Oh Lord, please inspire him to do something before it is too late. The repression of the security and military agencies tried at first the tactics of shock and awe, to borrow from Donald Rumsfeld, to intimidate the peaceful protesters, that is, nipping them in the bud, as the saying goes. This phase culminated in the first major massacre of peaceful civilian demonstrators in the city of Homs. Homs tried to replicate at the time the Tahrir Square experience of Cairo by a mass rally and demonstration in the city's central square, known as Clock Square. When it became evident that shock and awe was not working, as protest movement kept snowballing and spreading in spite of the mounting casualties, the repression went into what may be called the Pinochet phase, where schools, sports stadiums, hospitals, football fields, public facilities became mass detention centers. Prisons overflowed with the arrested at random, and torture reached an all-time high. When it became clear that Pinochet was not working either, and the protest movement simply went on spreading, intensifying, and deepening, the repression went into the Samson option phase. That is tearing down the Syrian temple on everybody's head, no matter what. Villages, towns, city quarters were literally razed to the ground. Agricultural crops burnt, trees and woods set on fire, schools, hospitals, bakeries, university buildings, health centers were systematically bombed and destroyed. Doctors, pharmacists, nurses, healthcare personnel were either imprisoned or killed. The Samson phase reached its predictable natural consequence in the poison gas attack on the villages of the Ghouta of Damascus, a well-covered and documented criminal act of desperation. The Samson option was not a mere decision of the moment, but a premeditated act whose time had come. Still imprinted on our minds are the whispers emanating from Rifat Assad's entourage since its heydays in the 70s of the last century, to the effect that we, the Assad clan, and the Alawites conquered Damascus by force of arms, and if they want it back, that is the Sunnah, we will return it only as a ruin. All this metamorphosed into the regime's current fighting slogans. Assad or La Ahad, Assad or no one else, and Assad or we burn the balad, Assad or we burn the whole country. Three additional factors contributed to the militarization of the Intifada, turning it into an armed revolt. First, the resulting attrition among the ranks of the more enlightened, educated, cultured, and skilled first layer of leaders energizing the peaceful and civil phase of the Intifada. Quickly, much of them ended up either dead or in jail or permanently impaired or out of the country. They would be successively replaced by new layers welling up from society's lower depths, necessarily less qualified, more fanatical, less progressive, and more disillusioned with the peaceful character of the whole popular protest movement. Second, the formation and rise of the Free Syrian Army as a consequence of the stream of defections at all ranks from the regular army when called upon to suppress the uprising using unrestrained violence. This is an issue of particular significance. I know, for example, that Europe and the United States did a lot of soul searching during the second half of the last century on the question of whether higher orders, especially higher military orders, do absolve those commanded from responsibility for their actions. The defectors from the Syrian army are spontaneously and without too much thinking living up to the norm that higher orders to commit crimes and atrocities do not in any way absolve those so commanded from responsibility for their actions and deeds. They live up to it by refusing superior orders to shoot at and bomb villages like their own villages, folks like their own folks, and city quarters like their own city quarters. This is the ethical meaning both of their defection and of putting their life and the lives of their families and relatives at great risk by refusing to obey higher orders of this kind. We should thank our stars as Syrians that the Syrian army is still a conscription and people's army and not a professional army. Third, the fact that the stakes are very high indeed for both sides in the struggle. On the one hand, what the Alawis, the backbone of the regime and of the repression, what they stand to lose is such an intolerable enormity that anything goes for them to continue holding on what they have now. On the other hand, the revolting Sunnah, the backbone of the Intifada, are currently under the absolute sway of a never again stand of resolve and determination to retrieve Syria from the usurpers. When Samson also failed to even diminish the armed Intifada, the regime let loose its paramilitary death squads, known as the Shabiha, against the rebelling population at large. Then Assad, to continue hanging on to power, had to call in successively the Hezbollah brigades from Lebanon, various Shia militias from Iraq and other countries, Iranian troops, as well as the Iranian military establishment itself, and finally, as a desperate measure of last resort, the Russian Air Force and its accompaniments. I would like all to say that Syria is not in a generalized civil war, because in the generalized civil war of Lebanon, the communities, sects, factions, and fractions of the country collectively mobilized and attacked and fought each other very ferociously, while the government in Lebanon and its state apparatuses pretty much helplessly stood by. In the case of Iraq, the occupation had abolished regime, state, army, and party. So it was the Shi'i and Sunni communities of the country, including the Kurds, that mobilized collectively and went to war against each other. In Syria, contrary to the Lebanon and Iraqi models, regime, state, army, and party remain the main and primary actors in pursuing scorched earth tactics and policies against both civilians and combatants in an attempt to stamp out the Intifada. There are no indications, for example, that Syria's Druzes are about to mobilize collectively to attack their Sunni neighbors in Huran, nor that the Sunnah common people are preparing to invade en masse Ismaili or Christian territories, nor are the Ismailis readying themselves to violently settle old scores with the Alami community, and so on. The Kurds carved out a niche for themselves and fight only in self-defense or to promote their own autonomy agenda. Neither did any Syrian community, sect, or ethnicity mobilize itself collectively to fight on the side of the regime or to defend it. Let me note as well that whatever excesses and extremisms come out of the uprising, they remain hardly anything in comparison with the excesses and extremisms of a genocidal dictator and power structure that are ready and willing to shower their own people with poison gas and barrel bombs. Syria is certainly not in a condition of generalized civil war. If a historical precedent and analogy be needed, I would recall Hungary's armed revolution against the Stalinist regime in 1956, a revolt successfully crushed by Russian tanks, exactly as is unsuccessfully happening in Syria today. As Hungary's revolution unfolded, no one ever said then or now that Hungary was in the throes of a generalized civil war because Hungarian was killing Hungarian. The regime of the two Assads is a hybrid construct out of the fascist traits embedded in the Ba'ath Party ideology and structure from a long time, from the time when Hitler and Mussolini were the models, and out of the mechanisms of surveillance, control, and oppression imported from Stalinist East Germany and Ceausescu's Romania. No one claims to know at present which way Syria is heading or what will be the final issue of this bloody struggle. Still, the one thing I am confident of is whichever way it all turns, the Assad dynasty can never rule Syria, and the Alawi minority can never have supremacy again. Still, Syria's civil society protest movement did its best for a whole year of punishing struggles to protect the character of the Intifada as a sacrificing civil protest against massive military repression and suppression. The movement was cynically led down by the International Friends of Syria group in favor of Obama's realpolitik of let Syria bleed, while at the same time it bleeds Iran, Hezbollah, Russia, and other anti-West forces. A realpolitik that backfired, creating enough space, time, and rage for ISIS and company to take root, organize, and conquer. Had the movement been properly aided, Syria now could have been something similar to Tunisia today. Instead, a situation similar to Libya evolved. It is important for European politics to realize that Europe's troubled Middle Eastern neighborhood is in the throes of a paradigm shift of historical proportions. The post-colonial, Cold War, Third Worldist models of state, society, and economy are dying after a long spell of stagnation, decay, and aimlessness. The slowly emerging new paradigm is still in the making, with so many forces, interests, and contenders vying and fighting to shape and form the new paradigm. In the forefront of this struggle right now are the Islamist and jihadist forces of reaction, alongside the more advanced movements of our still immature Arab civil societies that gave us, against all odds, the finest hours of the Arab Spring. As we all know, Syria is the eye of the storm blowing in Europe's direction. For European politics to accommodate in the name of practicality, Syria's crumbling ancien regime, its disintegrating structures, its oppressive apparatuses, its obsolete arrangements, its spent legitimacy, is to prolong the crisis, help empower the forces of reaction, disillusion the common people, and demoralize whatever civil society movement continues to exist. You may as well collaborate with Pol Pot to reform and stabilize Cambodia after the killing fields. Similarly, after Assad's campaigns of mass homicide, no anti-ISIS Syrian national unity or coming together is possible to reconquer Raqqa or liberate Mosul. Finally, I am confident that neither Iraq nor Syria will be permitted by the West to fall in the hands of Al-Qaeda or ISIS or any other form of jihadi Islam, even with boots on the ground and not just feet in the air. Similarly, after the Arab world lost Iraq to the domination of Iran and the Ayatollahs, the Arab states, supported by their allies, and especially the Sunni allies, will do everything in their power to prevent Syria and Lebanon from falling under the sway of the rule of Hezbollah and the Ayatollahs. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sadiq al-Azam, for this insight. I think it was extremely interesting. And I'm extremely interested to hear what Navid Kamani, who has also traveled Syria in the last years quite extensively, what he has to say and what he has to add.
Thank you very much. Let me begin with correcting a little bit an image which came in the introduction. I don't think that there's so much, so many differences in our points of view or in our regarding in our view on the history of Islamic societies or Arab societies. On the contrary, I mean, Sadiq al-Azam is one of the heroes of my study time, and we followed what he has written, and his, you know, his book on the critique of religious thinking was one of the most important books. And which, you know, we discussed as students, and of course his essay, especially on after the fatwa on Salman Rushdie, I think it was one of the most brilliant essays in the last decades of written by an Arab author. So on what I have read by Sadiq, and he's a friend of my own teacher of Stefan Wild. We met several times in the house of Stefan Wild in Bonn. So in what I've read from Sadiq, I didn't find too many differences. In contrary, I see myself as a pupil of people like Sadiq.
Thank you very much. So, this is really too much.
I wouldn't have said it, but you know, I have to. Don't expect a very controversial discussion. If you came here to find, you know, very different points of view. I fear that you will be disappointed, maybe. So that's also why I would like to add, sorry for this long remark, that of course I don't see, I'm not so kind of traditionalist to think that we should go back to golden era when Islam was so enlightened and now it's so dark. I think this is an image which I could really, really not could follow. And even there, I don't see that we would come to much, too many differences. But what I would like to add is not, you know, I don't want to correct or to say something different from about Syria from within in the presence of you and so many other Syrian friends here in the audience, but to say some remarks, you know, four remarks on the Syrian conflict from the view of Europe. You know, to add that perspective before we get into the discussion. And the first aspect I would like to add is more a question. You have said that had this movement be aided, you know, if there would have been support for the revolutionary movement in Syria. And this is really a matter, an issue which is really. I really think a lot about it, and it's whenever I think it's terrible to think about it, that this disaster in Syria and Iraq, it could have been avoided. I say it now. I mean, I was not so intelligent to say to know 4 or 5 years ago how it could, you know, what would be the best thing to do. I was very much in doubt what to do. I cannot say that read my articles 5 years ago, and if you had followed my points, then you would. No. I was. You know, myself. It was. We had the Iraq intervention. There was this Libya, this disaster in Libya. There was somehow. There was a very difficult. It was a difficult question what to do. in the beginning of the revolution, when it was still was peacefully, then when the massacres had begun. So I don't say from that I had been very clever at that time, but seeing it from now, I think that really what we did as European politics or European societies especially was the worst we could have done, doing nothing. I mean, I would say so, as mistaken the intervention in Iraq was, as disastrous was the non-intervention and nothing doing, to not do anything regards with Syria. It could not have went worse. This is really the worst scenario, both in Iraq and both in Syria. So I don't say that, you know, I don't speak of a military invasion in Syria. Nobody asked for a military invasion. It's not that we ask for that Syrian opposition said the West should invade Syria, but there had been means of support, especially in the beginning as the movement was peacefully. There was a really, and I remember how difficult it was, especially in our, let's say, leftish circle, to ask for support for the Russian revolutionary movement. You know, this is a Western movement. They are, you know, influenced by America. It's an American conspiracy. All this kind of cliches, which is still, you know, today I checked. I was, you know, saying what are the latest news in about Syria, and it just came to my, you know, I just came across an interview with the expert of the left party in Germany on Syria. You know, saying, well, the elections are not too bad now, you know, you have to see, you know, and I can't believe it, this kind of thinking that, you know, this Syrian revolution is a Western conspiracy against a kind of anti-American government. And so the support of the civil societies was not there. There was no demonstration in favor of the Syrian revolution. There was no pressure on politicians to do something. There was nothing. There was no debate in the newspapers, in the feuilletons, nothing. And I think this is really a disaster, not only for in terms of view of the politicians, but a disaster, if I see it now, in terms of this Western European, German, European civil societies. This lack of empathy when people risked their life and were killed for their for asking for freedom, for social security. And there had been means. I mean, the whole process, which has started now, let's say, for 4 or 5 months, diplomatic pressure, the UN, you know, Security Council, all this, you know, whether or not a non-flight zone. I'm not saying that it had been the best way, but it still could have been discussed. And afterwards also to support the Syrian Free Army before Daesh, before al-Nusra came in. But then to do nothing is to let other people do something, other states. You know, we have sitting there without really doing pressure on nobody, that other parties came in, like Saudi Arabia, like Qatar, like Iran, like Russia, like, you know, they used the vacuum. So this leads me to my second point, that, and this is something, it's true, sometimes I'm criticized for this point of view, that yes, sometimes we have to engage. I don't ask for war. I don't say that we should send troops in the first moment where it's possible. But you know, to think that any engagement is, you know, somehow something very bad, I think this is a very not only naive, it's a dangerous thinking. You know, if we regard this world as once, and I love this German coin of Willy Brandt so much, Weltinnenpolitik, of a world we have to, you know, then we have to engage in different means. And the military engagement is really the very, very, you know, it could be that there are situations where one has to engage military, but this is really very seldom. But there's so many other possibilities to engage. And just today I was walking with a friend and, you know, discussing, and she said, the situation got so bad in the world and, you know, I really feel the crisis. And I just thought, no, the situation didn't get worse. It's just that the conflicts come closer to us. That is the difference. It was not that the world had been better 5 years ago, 10 years ago, I mean, in Rwanda or wherever. I mean, there are so many other conflicts, but now these conflicts come closer and we cannot escape. You know, we see it in terms of refugees who come. They you know, this conflict, this crisis zone just came closer. And it's a result of a long-time policy, which I'm not saying that the West is responsible for everything, but still there are things the West, or especially Europe, could do differently. So between military engagement and doing nothing, it's a whole range of politics, and this is what I would ask for. So the third point I would just, you know, raise or just bring it to the discussion is Europe. You know, this is a conflict just on the in 3 hours with plane by away from Berlin, from Frankfurt, from Cologne. It's very close. It's at the border of Europe. So whatever happens there, whatever happens in Libya, this is different to Rwanda. Whatever happens in Libya, in Syria, in Iraq, in Turkey, in Kurdistan, it will affect us. There's no way of escape, no way to escape. And what we have seen in the last years, I mean, many people now talk about the crisis of the European project. This is a result also of the crisis of the European project, because there was no consistent European policy. Europe would have power, not only economic power, strategic power, and also in terms of, let's say, of ideal, you know, of ideas. And people, where do they go? They don't go to Russia, they don't go to Saudi Arabia, they still try to come to Europe. So Europe still stands for something, but what is Europe doing with this power it could have? Well, if they do, they do three or four, five policies at the same time. You know, at the outcome of the Arab Spring, France wanted to support Ben Ali in Tunisia, sent him troops and sent him weapons. Others did support other ones. You know, this whole idea of Mittelmeer process, process of Mediterranean process, which is, you know, it's just a disaster of European policy. It was a strategy of supporting explicitly the dictatorships of the Middle East. This was the outspoken policy of the European Union. So I don't say that Europe is responsible for everything, but especially in this situation of crisis, when you have a foreign commissioner, which at that time, which nobody even of you remember her name, and don't be sad to not remember the name of the European foreign commissioner of that time, what was it, Lady Ashton? You know, doing, you know, it was just the influence Europe could have. It took it out. It took itself out of the game. And that means other could come. And the last point I would like to add, I come back to the first remark, is why liberation, why freedom has become such a bad name into left circles? Why freedom movement are not supported? Why the green movement in Iran in 2009 had so few sympathies on the left side, but was supported by other people? Why the Arab revolutions were not supported by those who one would think are close to them, those who ask for freedom? Why we see that not only the left party in Germany, but all over Europe, those, you know, leftish movements are so critical and are so hesitant to support freedom movement in other parts of the world. You know, my own political socialization in the 80s, you know, was supporting freedom movement in Nicaragua and South America and whatever. What happened to that? To this now, the same kind of milieu rather stands with Putin and with Assad and even with the Ayatollahs than with those who raise their voice against these dictators. And I got alienated by my own milieu, maybe not the Heinrich Böll Stiftung, which I see that is doing something at least, but and you know, we're sitting here, but this kind of, you know, I get so angry and tired by this whole, you know, this cynicism about people who want to live in freedom and are ready to sacrifice their life and their work and for the sake of freedom. And so I'm sure Heinrich Böll, who's another hero of my student time, and who at his time, you know, supported Lev Kopolev and many other figures, you know, also not very, very, also not have so many sympathies in their own milieu because, you know, they were against the kind of, they were dissidents. Well, I think this is still today the position we should take, is to support the dissidents and not the dictators. And so that's why I'm happy to sit here and have the honor to sit here with Lev Kopolev of our time. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I just have one question before we go and see what Sadiq al-Azm has to say and to react to your comments. Do you have an answer to your last question? Why didn't they support?
Well, it would be probably not a very clear answer, but I have certain, you know, I see certain things, and I see that the issue of social equality has got more important, the equality issue, than the freedom issue. You know, sometimes because freedom ideas has been taken by the right wing kind of neoconservative and the right wing's freedom has been associated with liberal freedom. You know, as it has gotten a right wing idea in a way, you know, to put it very simply. So on the left side, one has got hesitant about the idea of freedom because it is, and of course also because of the wars. You know, one of the worst thing about this Iraq war is that it has discredited the idea of freedom, of supporting freedom, you know, in the name of freedom, of war against, in the name of freedom. So this is also, of course, we had many wars in the name of freedom, which did everything but not support freedom. So, and also, I cannot escape this dilemma. I said at the beginning, 4 or 5 years, I was not so resolute about this point, whether to intervene or how to intervene.
Thank you. So I think we have the two sides, European side, the Syrian side, Syria from inside and from outside. Sadiq al-Azm, what would you like to add to what Navid said?
Well, first of all, my great appreciation for your generous comments and remarks. And certainly, you know, I've always felt, you know, the mental and emotional affinity to what you are doing, and I've read also your work with great admiration, and you are a master both in English and German and in Farsi, I'm sure. concerning Europe, there was a time when the neighborhood of Europe was known as the sick man of Europe, and now the man is still sick, by the way. He is not cured yet. And of course, this is blowing again onto the European continent. And we should not stand before the false dilemma that either you send troops or you do nothing in action or boots on the ground. I think this is a trick in order to avoid action or doing something about it and justify the Obama's policy or realpolitik of let Syria bleed. And it's bleeding a lot of others with it. Of course, this policy is, you know, reacting or backfiring by producing ISIS and Nusra and Hezbollah coming into Syria and so on. And at the same time, of course, creating the refugee crisis in Europe. And when, you know, the big powers want to help, they know how to do it. And when they want to destabilize, they know how to destabilize. And when they want to support, they know how to support. So one should not be naive, you see, about this. I think there is a lot of hypocrisy in the official declarations that we hear. Apropos of the left, like you, I hail from the left too. And I'm just as stunned and flabbergasted at their, you know, the position that is being taken vis-a-vis Syria. And it seems the main point, somehow, they are convinced that the Assad regime is really a secular regime. Well, the regime continued whatever secularism there is in Syrian society. In Syria, you know, Syria doesn't apply, for example, Sharia at all, okay? And the ulama and our ayatollahs do not rule and govern before Assad or after, I hope after Assad. On the contrary, the regime of the two Assads, because it's a minoritarian regime, it had a sense, a deep sense of deficiency in legitimacy. So they went out of their way to compensate for this deficiency by building more mosques than all the nationalist leaders that have come before them, okay, who were all Sunni and good Muslims, okay, by creating, you know, Quranic schools, by pampering the Ayatollahs of Syria, by going conspicuously and ostentatiously to the Hajj, to the pilgrimage. And they have done all that with a lot of spectacle and propaganda with it. Still, I don't know why this doesn't, you know, penetrate to the to the left. That, you know, they still continue somehow that it's a regime that is supposed to be still secular. Apropos of the left, the other side of it, and in the Arab left split into basically two or three factions. When the bigger faction went into a civil society program, human rights, independent initiative in society, freedoms, you know, the social justice, basically a lot of the slogans and aspirations and symbols of the Arab Spring came from this. From the, you know, this side of the the smaller section of the Arab left decided that no, we will continue the fight against imperialism and Zionism and the conspiracy and so on, and they joined either Hezbollah or Al-Qaeda, or, you know, it could be some of them, you know, could have gone all the way to in the direction of Daesh or ISIS. This is the situation that, and they don't have any coherent position anymore. Okay, I mean, they've been disrupted in this way. Now, one last thing about Iraq. I think whatever you say about Iraq, I think the removal of Saddam was decisive and very important. And one can argue, okay, about the impact and role of the removal of Saddam in hastening, if not making, the Arab Spring possible. The feeling before the removal of Saddam was that everything was bottled up. History was at a standstill. Everything was, you know, rudderless, aimless. We were going nowhere. And after his removal, everything kind of came out. And history started to flow. And of course, it's violent also when history flows. So I, you know, whatever the, if you want a redeeming thing about, you know, what Bush did, okay, it's the fact that, you know, he removed somebody like Saddam Hussein from power, which the Iraqi opposition has been working for years and years and years, okay? And unfortunately, they were not able to do it themselves. They had to go to the Americans to do it for them. At least in Syria, we are trying to do it ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you raised a very good point as well, adding to what Navid said when to answer to the question why the European left or the activists who used to get engaged with other freedom movements were reluctant to or hesitated to get involved with Syria. This was religion. And many thought, oh, if we now support one of the groups, then we will end up supporting a fundamentalist or Islamist group. You started to talk about the subject you mentioned in the beginning that you wanted to talk about the role of religion in the conflict. When you were talking about this not really existing secularism of the Bashar al-Assad regime. What else can you say about the role of religion in the Syrian conflict at the moment?
Well, first of all, of course, the kind of official line, both in the opposition as well as the regime, is that relations between the sects and ethnicities have always been milk and honey, which is, of course, nonsense. There were always tensions and problems and issues. But at least for Syria, from the time when it was established immediately after the First World War, there was no systematic repression or systematic suppression or attacks on any of the minorities. And the minorities themselves, in terms of their daily life, it went on, you know, pretty ordinary, customary fashion. Okay, the problems earlier that are famous in his history occurred during when the Ottoman Empire. Okay, but after when Syria was established, okay, there was no persecution, okay, systematic of any of the troubles that we see now. Of course, there is a lot of things that are latent. If you come and stir them up, they come up. And the regime played a big role in stirring up all this. And of course, not only the regime, other powers too. In other words, those in power, be it Saudi Arabia, be it Iran, be it Qatar, and so on, very often have a stake in stirring up the latent and sleeping tensions, stresses, conflicts between Sunni, Shi'i, Alawi, Druze, and and so on. Now, at this time in Syria, you have the spontaneous Islam of the common people. This is neither ideological nor political. It is centered on ibadat and mu'amalat, centered on acts of worship and the transactions of life, basically daily life Islam, okay, which interacts between in the marketplace, you sell, you buy, and so on. You don't ask what is your religion or your sect or anything like that. This is the base for it. Then you have, especially in the cities and the towns, you have middle-class Islam, which is Islam good for business. Good for business Islam, okay? That also is not ideological. It is, to some extent, political, but it's political in a practical and a utilitarian way, okay? In other words, it's Islam, it's good for business, it promotes it and creates networks and so on. Then have come to Syria, okay, and this is imposed really, is jihadi Islam and ISIS type of Islam. And now as far as I know, Syria has not produced any major terrorists or non-leaders in the terrorist organizations, in Al-Qaeda or Saudi Arabia has produced a lot, for example. North Africa has produced a lot, but Syria has not. On top of all that is, of course, petro-Islam. And I think petro-Islam, right, is in many ways responsible over a historic period of time for breeding both ideologically, emotionally, and financially, okay, what we call political Islam, and which metamorphosed into jihadism. In Syria now, the way I expect that what will stabilize the society religiously is a combination of good for business Islam and spontaneous Islam of the people, okay, which are not in conflict. There may be class conflict, that's a different matter, okay? But religiously, this will be a stabilizing factor, especially if we, Syria start reconstructing, and the reconstruction process usually attracts all the attention, and you put aside, you know, the vendettas and the settling of scores and so on. Maybe something like what happened in Lebanon immediately after the war with the reconstruction of Lebanon and the rise of someone like Rafiq al-Hariri, which was, to a great extent, you could say, the golden moment after the civil war there. So I am banking on things like that in terms of religion, on the good for business Islam, the spontaneous Islam of the common people.
Yeah, maybe I would like to comment or to add to this point, and also with regard to the question you have raised before, why we certain the leftish milieu doesn't support this kind of freedom movement and out of fear of Islam, as Sadiq said. Well, this is not only the point of view of the leftish movement in Europe. It goes beyond the leftish milieu. It's a general fear, and also not only in the West. You know, those who come from Syria knows exactly this kind of tone. That, you know, this is a factor of Assad, which he makes policy of it, is to say that because he's the hero of laicism and of fear of Islam, one has to have a laic dictatorship. You know, better a laic dictatorship than a democracy, because if you have democracy, then the stupid people will come and they will go for the Islamists. This kind of Kemalist old point of view, the people are too stupid. So we have to decide what to do. So the idea that secularism is identical with democracy And religiosity is similar with dictatorship. This is a cliche which is absolutely not, goes not with reality, these countries. And in a way, we have the paradox situation that out of fear of Islamism, we are doing everything to strengthen Islamism because we crash them down. We are, let's say, the states crash them down like the Algerian model or like in Egypt or like in Syria. And we don't allow people to breathe out of fear that if they breathe, they would speak out in favor of the wrong ideas. And this is, of course, ideologically the best support for Islamist movement because they can say, look, they don't want to have freedom. And they radicalize more and more, and this happened in the last over the last years, beginning with Algeria, you know, I don't know, it would have been very dangerous to let them come to power, but this way, 100,000 of people have died, you know, through the civil war, and we have the jihadi movements, and we have jihadists from Algeria going to other countries, and we had this jihadi. You know, still suffering from this civil war there. So, in my point of view, is really, maybe it sounds really a little bit romantic or naive, but we have no way to try freedom and to get into a discussion and into debate and to stand for the ideals which we have, even then when we fear that they don't have the majority, we have to fight for the majority. And this has happened. This hasn't happened in many cases. And I remember the last time I was in Syria in 2012, and I was in Damascus and all the other cities. This people. Having their whiskey, being very liberal, very, you know, kind of close, culturally very close to us, but speaking like, you know, as a brute way, the most brute way one could imagine about the desire of the people. And this kind of, you know, my English, Verachtung, this detest of the common people. Is something which I really hardly can stand, and that's why people like you, who are, you know, probably I wouldn't think of any more secular than you, Sadiq, but and maybe at the end you would come to some controversies at the end of the day, but still is the most important thing is still the idea of freedom that people have. Could have to make that choice and not be fearful of what people would like to do.
May I add something to what you said from the point of view of conspiracy theory? And of course, conspiracy theories are endemic in the Middle East. And one time, Fred Halliday told me that there are one people in the conspiracy theory that are worse than the Arabs, and that's the Iranians. He said.
Not all of them.
And now, with the Panama Papers that have come out, Putin is saying that the Panama Papers are a conspiracy of the United States to destabilize Russia. Okay? And, you know, and this is, you know, in the middle of Europe, okay? And when they are all, you know, supposedly very rational and planning and so on. What you said about, you know, the fundamentalists, and if you remember the rise of Daesh, of ISIS, was so sudden, all the radars of the big powers are concentrated on Iraq and Syria. All the security apparatuses and so on are focused on of the regional powers, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Turkey, and so on, concentrated on Syria and Iraq. And all of a sudden, this giant comes out of the bottle, okay, and looms over every, you know, and it becomes, you know, everybody say, is speaking about Daesh and, of course, about ISIS, to the point that it seemed to have become an obsession. And this is what leads to conspiracy theories. There was no explanation. If all the radars of the big powers were Syria and Iraq, okay, how can something suddenly emerge out of the bottle like that and loom so large, okay, without them either knowing about it or maybe causing it in the mind of many people? So we heard that, you know, Daesh is, you know, an Iranian invention, creation, an American creation, a Turkish creation, and Kurdish creation. And everyone, you know, has termed Daesh a creation of, you know, the guy that they hate and they don't like. This is how this spreads and come. And until now, in the literature I've read coming out, questions are asked, is Daesh really Islamic or not Islamic, okay? But how did it escape your attention and how did it come up like that, which is flabbergasted, you know? I had friends who never thought of conspiracy theories told me that it makes you want to believe in conspiracy theory in spite of yourself. Okay, the way the Daesh thing has blown up and grew in such a manner. Add to it the fact that it is a very strong feeling that fighting it is not very serious. The fight against it is not, you know, being conducted as seriously as it's, you know, either declared and said, or as one would expect.
Thank you very much. Before we open the floor for your questions, I think we will have time for a small round of questions or comments from your side, so everybody can have their say. I would like to ask the two panelists. You said 5 years ago you did not know what to do, and now you would know what we should have done 5 years ago. Do you know what we should do now?
No, I leave that answer to Sadiq and follow the command of Sadiq, because I think he said at one point I would like to make a little bit different remark. I think that the rising of Daesh was not so, you know, that they invade Iraq and Mosul, that was a surprise, it's true, but still it had a long history before. We had this Islamization of public sphere for many years, and it started many years ago, this whole idea of not only political Islam, but also the center of civil societies Islamized more and more and became more and more kind of influenced by Wahhabiti thought, that newspapers changed their tone, that, you know, I remember that when I was in Cairo in the beginning, it started, you know, when in for the first time in 89, I guess, or something like that. It's not only the scarf, but it's a way of discussing things. I mean, of course, the scarf is also a symbol that hardly any woman in Cairo had a scarf at the time. And now, at that time, and I remember there a common friend, the late Nasr Abu Zayd, how he was, you know, when he raised his voice and he was condemned by the Arab civil society, people who raised their voice against Islamism, and he was driven out of the university just because he said that these people are you know, criticized this kind of Islamization of public sphere. And there were, of course, some supporters, but it was not a mass support of this kind of people. And so for many years, For many years, in the Arabic and in the Middle Eastern societies, we followed this wave of a very superficial and bizarre and you know kind of Wahhabi Islam, influencing everything, influencing our thinking, dividing the world in between believers and unbelievers. This whole notions of, you know, of this is not something new. I mean, this Daesh continues, radicalizes something which has started many years ago, and only very few people, like intellectuals like Sadr al-Azm and Nasr Abu Zayd and some others, have, you know, have mentioned it in the public sphere, and that they were not very much supported by the Arab societies, civil societies. And so maybe now, and this is my last remark here at this point, is that now, because of this disaster we see now, it's not a people see what political Islam leads to at the end. My impression is that we don't see the, let's say, the peak of political Islam, but we see the turning down of the idea of political Islam, and it creates not only a lot of noises, but also a lot of victims and a lot of destructions. But it's not the sign of an emerging force, but it's a downfall of an idea. And I would like to hear what you think about that.
The last point about political Islam, could you?
Yeah, well, I think that this jihadi movement of nowadays, it's not the peak of political Islam, but it's really the downfall of the political idea of political Islam. And once it has been overcome, this idea will be weakened very much. So it's not the sign of strength of political Islam. It's a sign of the downfall.
Well, this is very clear with what happened to the Muslim Brothers. Okay, they, you know, now they are in total disarray and have disintegrated, and they, in the Arab world, represent the, you know, fundamental and primary form and of political Islam, out of which came out the violent kind of Islam. Now, here I call it action direct Islam. Okay, in other words, they have been waiting for the Khilafah to come, and they say that the Muslim Brother leadership and so on keeps saying that the objective, in the old Marxist terminology, the objective conditions are not ripe for yet the Khilafah. A lot of, you know, the younger, you know, became impatient and said, until when we are going to, you know, wait until the objective conditions are ripe. So we use action direct, violence, in order to make them ripe, to ripen them. So in this sense, you know, these movements have destroyed the political Islam, the traditional political Islam that we have known in the form of the Muslim Brothers and like them. About, you know, Europe, I think the idea circulating that somehow you can get the Syrian fighting opposition to team up with Assad in order to fight ISIS, okay, I find that grotesque, okay, after everything that happened, okay. But it seems to get repeated both here in certain circles and in the United States. The idea is, you know, is that which one is the lesser evil? Well, the lesser evil for whom? For Europe and America, or lesser evil for Syria also? We have to think about that. In terms of what is to be done now that the Geneva negotiations, my sense of the negotiation is that this is not really negotiation. There are more crisis management going on in Geneva than serious negotiations. And crisis management, the way the Americans conduct it, is based on a lot of what they call constructive ambiguities. So we have a lot of constructive ambiguities, and because of the ambiguity, there is agreement, and then you push forward the moment when you have to resolve the ambiguity. And this is constantly going on, and this is the third time they meet in Geneva, and they keep postponing the constructive ambiguity on and on. I think if they want to do something, whether Europe or the United States, is to finish with this kind of, it's beginning to look like the Palestinian peace process. The process is everything, the goal is nothing. And I'm afraid that, this Syria will maybe falling into something like that. I think what we need seriously from Europe and the West is something like what happened in Bosnia and Kosovo. Okay, in other words, agreement, okay, where they took these people and put them in what was it, Camp David or Dayton, okay. In other words, what we need is a Dayton agreement in Syria, rather than the kind of negotiations that are going on. And I think the parallels with the war in Kosovo and Bosnia and so on are very relevant. And only in the direction of going in some kind of a Dayton-like agreement, okay, can really stabilize Syria and prevent what could come could be worse, because our societies have a very strong culture of vendetta, okay, of settling scores, of retaliation. And if there is no containment from now and so on, this could, spill a lot of blood later on. And there is definitely now in the movement, I know from talking to a lot of people and so on, there is a wing in the movement which is interested only in taking revenge. All they want is taking revenge against the Alawis and their accomplices, and they don't care about Syria, about transitional justice, about social peace and so on. And sometimes I think short of a Mandela, we are not going to get out of it. And of course, Mandelas don't come easy.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for a small round of questions. So, here's one.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, especially from Sadiq Al-Azm for his speech. I think there's one more point that, of the Western illusions. It's not only about Assad and the Syrian opposition should come together against ISIS, but also we have heard many times here that this would be a brilliant opportunity finally to get some agreement with the Iranian regime that they must be interested in teaming up with the West and vice versa against ISIS. So from this current position, I would like to have some words from you as from your intellectual experience, how would you position the importance of the Islamic Revolution in 79 for the rise of Islamism of all sorts since that time, Sunni and Shia? Because I don't know if everyone knows, you have already criticized Edward Said in 1980, and you wrote much about how the intellectual discourse changed after 79 in the Arab intellectual societies. So could you say some assessment about that?
So I think we can take two more questions and then answer them together.
Thank you very much. Navid, you correctly brought up how the left has ignored much of what's happening in Syria, in Iraq, in many countries, but I feel the left has not ignored the region. While slaughtering was going on in Syria, there were constantly demonstrations against Israeli artists speaking or playing music or doing an art exhibit in Sweden or in England or in the States. The European left and the American far left has indeed focused on certain conflicts at the expense of others. The United Nations has not ignored the Middle East, they just have focused on Israel. My question is if you can comment on that, and if you feel that perhaps now is an opportunity for the left to be a bit more reflective and to possibly expand its horizons and depoliticize many conflicts, so we don't have a situation like Biafra.
Okay, we can take one more question.
My question is for Sadiq. You used the word intifada, not revolution, and we are hearing a lot like crisis, a movement will become revolution. But why you used intifada?
In my speech, talk, and discussions and so on, I've used both terms. Because I think what happened in Syria can be, contains both elements. Because I also use it because the third intifada has entered into practically all languages and is, recognized by all people, everybody. And because sometimes some people think that the word revolution is in a maximalist sense, okay? And what is happening in Syria is a revolution, but not necessarily in the maximalist sense of the word. So I think intifada is also an adequate equivalent to describe what happened in Syria. There is also the factor that the feeling that Syria is occupied, okay, by this, highly militarized regime and its supporters, okay? And, of course, the intifada was against an occupation. And that, of course, played a role also in my thinking about it. And I prize the intifada, and I think I'm, I'm proud that Syria goes into an intifada too, okay? Because I also, admire the intifada and was in praise of it, also thinking of what's the uprising in Syria in terms of an intifada. Concerning the Islamic Revolution in Iran, it was very absolutely momentous and very important. The Arab left was mesmerized by it, and to the point that I know, some old communists who were not even Muslims, okay, who became Muslims when Shia Muslims among some Palestinians and Lebanese and so on, old-time Stalinists. Okay, they spent time in jail at the time where communism was still a Stalinist creature. The political Islam in the Arab world after the Islamic Revolution in Iran sort of thought this way. If they can, the Shia can do it, we can do it. And the movements of the Jama'at, the armed Jama'at in Egypt, started early 80s. It was, you know, around the time of the Islamic Revolution in Iran and after it. And they started, of course, you know, attacking the state, but, you know, like a lot of the attempts of political Islam have failed. The really founding moment of especially the intellectual or mental documents that came out from the political Islam in the Arab world came out from Egypt, especially in that period, especially something like al-Farid al-Ghaibi of Abd Salam Faraj, okay? The absent commandment, the duty of jihad. This was, you know, a very important founding document, okay? And also the writings of Shikri Mustafa, who was the leader and theoretician of the group, or the known as the excommunication and migration, takfir wal hijra. Okay, in other words, you excommunicate society as jahili, as pre-Islamic, okay, godless, and you migrate out of it the way the Prophet migrated out of Mecca to Medina, and build yourself there, and then reconquer that society by re-Islamizing it properly, the way the Prophet reconquered Mecca after his experience in Medina. So all these things, you know, came up and boiled over and so on after the Islamic Revolution in Iran.
Well, the question you have raised regarding Israel, well, I agree with your point of view. It's the same thing I also see in the last years, not in the sense that I would ask not to criticize or not to put pressure on Israel. I think this is important, especially with view of the Israeli policy in the last years and the radicalization of Israeli policy in the last years. I think there is not, I mean, this is something which is needed, especially by the civil society, by intellectuals. One could discuss about the forms, but of course it goes together with a protest against other with dictatorships like in Iran. So I ask myself, why are those who go, let's say, to a demonstration against the regime in Iran, they should be the same people, and not other people, that ask for support for the Palestinians. At the moment, we have really the situation that either you go to that, you're against that, or against that, and this weakens both positions, because if you make the point clear that you are with you know, in support of oppressed people wherever they are. Maybe in Ukraine, where also an issue where, you know, there was not much support of, let's say, the Maidan movement, or in Israel, or in Iran, or wherever, then you, of course, you strengthen your position. But if you concentrate on one conflict and say only these people, you know, they should move, and ignoring other conflicts and other dictatorships and other, you know, situations of oppression, then your voice, of course, naturally will be much less heard and has much less authority. So yes, in general, I agree with your point.
Thank you very much. I could sit here for another 5 hours listening to you both, but I think even good discussions need to come to an end, and I'm sure it was not the last time. So what I would like to know from you, just to get an idea what the next discussion could be about, what subjects are you working on at the moment? What is interesting from your point of view?
Well, my next book will be far away from all the conflicts. It will be a novel, and so it has not so much to do with this. Although any novel play in nowadays times also somehow absorbs the political discussions in a way, but very indirectly. But of course, what I continue to follow is it's not only that the monuments, the historical monuments, are destroyed in the terms of of mosques and churches and all this. This is in a way we are also in an intellectual sense archaeologists of this culture, because many of the texts like texts of the 10th century, 9th century, 11th century, we lose our connections to, they are not any understood anymore. And this link, so I see myself in a way, or feel to be sometimes an archaeologist, an archaeologe, not in the sense of going to an archaeologist in a war zone, trying still to make this kind of texts comprehensible. That these texts, if you want to study, let's say, Ibn Arabi, nowadays, one does not go to Mecca where Ibn Arabi has written his Meccan revelations. You have to go to London. And this stands for the culture. That Abu Nuwas, if you want to have a good edition of Abu Nuwas, you probably go to Al-Saqi in London and not anymore to Cairo. And this stands for something. That the most relevant texts of Arabic and Islamic and Persian culture are on the verge of still they are there, but the societies are about to lose their connection with these texts.
And the last word should always go to the teacher. So, Sadiq Al-Azm, what are the next subjects you're working on?
My interest right now is to follow the panicky atmosphere in Germany and the European Union concerning the refugee crisis. Okay. I attended a high-level conference the other day under the patronage of the President of the Republic at the Korber Stiftung, and I heard almost apocalyptic hyperbole about, crossroads, and turning points, and even, Hamletian, to be or not to be for the European Union, the protecting the, Christian values of the West. I was stuck because I said, look, this is, this kind of talk in the Arab world is daily bread. But we don't think Europe is, normally, speaks that way. That's the first time I see it. And on the question of, religion and the Christian values of the West, the Europeans forget that Christianity is not a European religion. It is a Middle Eastern religion. We gave it to you. And it was all started by a Palestinian Jew. Don't forget that.
I think this was a very nice last word. I'm sure this is going to be continued. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. It was nice to have such a big audience for this interesting discussion. Have a good and safe way home, and see you next time.
Yeah.